So tonight I'm chilling out with a beer from a new brewery that I haven't tried before. This is Low Life Barrel House's Dark Mild. Don't know much about it other than it says chocolate, raisin, and nutty in the flavor profiles, which I guess is represented by the picture on the can. Today I am doing a kit build. And as requested by some people in a recent comment section, it is this kit here, which is a little FM transmitter kit that I got a few mailbags back. There's not a huge number of components in this kit, but enough to make it an interesting challenge. Of course, the circuit board is fairly well marked with the component values on it and stuff, although they are in random orientations on the labeling. Some stuff is labeled this way up, the microphone's labeled this way up, audio in is labeled that way up, these resistors are labeled that way up. Well, on the back side we have nice generous sized pads, good solder mask. All in all, should be a fairly straightforward kit to put together. Just for reference, this is the EQ kit RF02FM. I'll put a link to places you can buy it down below. But since I was able to find a schematic online, I don't have to draw it, and you don't have to suffer from my horrible drawing. So here we go. Power in here. We have an Electret microphone, condenser mic, that gets its bias from there. DC block capacitor. Single NPN transistor amplifier. 100K feedback resistor. And then that output goes to the normally closed on the input jack. The input jack's a stereo jack, so it is going to both the left and the right common together there. Then if you are using a stereo input, that gets mixed down to mono this way, or you know, splitting back to mono again that way from this. Another DC block capacitor. Here we have LC tank circuit. Essentially, this circuit will resonate at a particular frequency as amplified by this transistor over here, and the frequency is tuned or adjusted slightly by this adjustable inductor, so we can tune it to whatever frequency we can within range that it's of its design. But also the audio coming through here will modulate that. It will add a DC bias to this circuit here, so as it's oscillating, it's going to be mixing with that variable voltage that is the audio signal, which will be varying the frequency of the oscillator. Out of this oscillator slash amplifier transistor, out the collector, we have another inductor, which is the load resistor for the AC component, and then a resistor that is the load resistor for the DC component of this transistor. That's all in the load circuit, and then in the feedback we have a little capacitor, just doing a little bit of filtering. Then DC block across to this NPN transistor, which is just a straight up linear amplifier, and feedback resistor there, AC load resistance there, another DC block capacitor, and then a little Pi circuit here, which is essentially acting as impedance match to the antenna, and then out the antenna. So it is three transistors, two of them being amplifiers, one of them being part of the oscillator. Fairly straightforward circuit, fairly standard basic little FM transmitter. It's essentially a Mr. Microphone, but you can put other audio into it as well. Power input, audio input. There's the three transistors, handful of inductors. There is the variable inductor, and there is one of the several fixed inductors. The variable inductor basically has its coil sitting there vertically, and then it has a little ferrite slug in it that you can screw down inside to change the inductance of that, which will, as I said, change the frequency of the circuit. What else do we have in here? Oh, there's an LED in here, so it's got a power light, which isn't showing in the schematic. Whatever, it's just a power light. And a bunch of little ceramic capacitors, handful of resistors, and assuming they've designed it properly and supplied the proper components, it should work first try without much dickery. At worst, we'll have to adjust the frequency of the output. But I think resistors is a good place to start. And it looks like there's only about 4 different values of resistors. Yep, those are all 10Ks. All right. That should be pretty straightforward. And what are these two ones here? 47K. Okay, 46K, 47K really is what they are. So I'll throw those guys in first and get moving on this thing. Shorted anything yet? Good. So now there is a ton of capacitors in this. Let's put the big electrolytic in first. 100 microfarad, 16 volt. Not because it's a small component, but because it's just the first one that I grabbed. There's always a lot of capacitors in RF circuits just to keep the RF where going where it's supposed to go and not going where it's not supposed to go. According to the schematic, there's a bunch of different values. I can't just grab at them. I've got to actually look at them. All right, so be it. I apologize for the nulling. I won't let it happen again. I know it's unaccustomed to see on my channel. But anyway, we have some 101, which I expected to find, a 30, actually, 330s. These two guys over here, which I don't know, 102, I think. And then over here, 66 and 15. It's like a where's Waldo or where's Wally, depending on what continent you're in. 15. There it is, right down there. That was a lot of capacitors. Next, let's put in the inductors. Just like capacitors, there are often quite a number of inductors in RF circuits. So on this board, they don't have the inductors labeled with their actual value of microhenries and millihenries. They've just got them labeled how many turns. There's an 8-turn inductor there, a 5-turn inductor there, an 8-turn there, and a 7-turn, which is a variable, there. So let's put these guys in place. Not too many components left to go on here. Should put the microphone on next? Sure. And the silk screen tells you which direction to put it on. But if it didn't, notice that this pin is bonded to the shell and that one isn't. So the one bonded to the shell is going to be the negative. I guess let's also put the LED in as well. Just making sure that they sent us a functional LED. Yep, that works. So long lead is the positive side. Short lead is the negative side. The only real difficulty I've had soldering on this board so far is components that are onto the ground plane, just because the ground plane has a lot more copper, a lot more thermal mass to it. That's not unique to this board. That happens a lot of times. It's just something you got to be aware of, that's all. So here is the audio input jack, and as mentioned earlier, it is a switching stereo type of jack. So yeah, that goes there, and the DC input goes there. What are we saying about ground plane? Yeah, this power jack is being a real bear. Now all that's left is the 3 transistors. If I remember correctly, they're all NPN, but but they're different. 9014, 9018, 9018. So 9014 is the audio preamp. Let's get it in place and remember to pay attention to the orientation on the silkscreen there. Yes, I've made that mistake before. Now these two are both 9018s. They are, without looking at the data sheet, they're going to be higher frequency capable, and they will work a lot better if I put them in the right direction. What happens when I get yakking to you guys? I start making mistakes. Yeah, these ones will be capable of a little bit higher frequency because, like I said, they are in the RF portion. And being higher frequency, they're likely a little bit more expensive. They probably could have used them in the audio amplifier section as well, but probably just to save on cost, they did it this way. I think that is the end of the soldering. Oh, no, there's one more pad there. Let's strip the end of the antenna wire off. Give it a little twist so it comes through nicely. There. Now the soldering's complete. Ah, well, that was pretty straightforward, all in all. A couple of things were a little bit difficult to solder, but all in all, not too bad. So I guess we should power it on and see if it works. According to the silk screen, it says it takes between DC 3 and 6 volts. So 4.1 volts should be plenty out of this guy here. Where's negative? That side, right. First thing, let's see. Oh, the LED turns on. That's always a good sign. Now then, how do we test it? Should I just YOLO this and grab a radio? Sure, or no, I'll hook up the scope. That would be the proper thing to do, wouldn't it? Okay, I've got my scope probe hooked up to the antenna and grounded just to the audio ground, which should be the whole electrical ground for the circuit. Got my scope running, and as you can see, we have a waveform. And this thing looks like it's transmitting or oscillating at about 51.6 megahertz. So, as I was mentioning before, if I adjust the slug, the ferrite slug on this inductor, I should be able to change the frequency of the oscillation. Oh my goodness, that is nasty. What have we got there? We've got overtones and weird crap. Let's keep going. Oh, there we got a nice sine wave. Well, nicer anyway. Okay. That looks a lot healthier. Let's see what that is. It's a little bit unstable. That is... So now we've got about 84.9 megahertz. That makes sense. And it's hard to see. Tapping on the microphone, there's a little tiny disturbance in there, but we should be able to see the audio waveform on that if I put a tone against it. Hang on here, just give me a second. Right, so now I have my waveform generator here set up with a sine wave output. I'll attenuate it right down, connect that. And as we turn up the attenuation, you can see on the scope that there is modulation happening. The waveform's starting to get all shaky. I don't think I can zoom in tight enough to see it exactly, but, and there is also some kind of noise on there, which I think is just because this circuit isn't shielded from interference in the space. That's my guess anyway. But you can definitely see it modulating that. Let's see if we can hear this with a radio. Okay, let's try this. It should be way down at the bottom of the... Oh, there it is. Cool. Oh, that's awesome. How far up could we go? Sorry about your ears. I can still hear it. Unfortunately, there is quite a little background hum. That is 60 cycle hum. That is just the environment that I'm in, unfortunately, because I've got so much, you know, electrical stuff going on around me, the lights, the computer, the scope, everything. But it works. It works. And it runs off a battery. And it, well, let's just see. Okay, let's just disconnect all this stuff from it, and I'll come over here. Hello, 1, 2, 3. Oh, hey, it's working. Can you hear me if I back up a little bit? Of course you can. And of course it feeds back, as you would expect the microphone in front of a speaker to do so. Wow, it works. First try, excellent. Like I said, it is noisy in here. There is electrically noisy, I mean, so that hum is going to happen. But it actually works, and I didn't have to do any messing around. I just had to tune it a little bit. The way it came from the factory, the slug was right up at the top, so I had to run it down a little bit to get it to a reasonable sine wave on the scope, and also to get it to where it was in the FM band. So there's where we actually were, right at the very, very bottom of the FM broadcast band, at least the North American FM broadcast band. Where it was initially, it was way down below, so I couldn't have picked it up with the radio. But once I tuned it to get that reasonably decent sine wave on the scope, then it was just on the edge of the band, right where we could find it. All in all, I think that's a pretty good beginner level kit for somebody who wants to get into RF. Of course, you have to tune it, but you could just tune it to a radio. Just turn the radio to somewhere down in the bottom of the band and then just adjust this until you hit it. It's not powerful enough to interfere with any commercial broadcasts, so that shouldn't be an issue with legality or anything else. Depends on, I guess, what the FM broadcast band is in your country. But other than that, it's a pretty good little circuit. You probably want to put it inside a metal box, with the antenna sticking out, just to minimize the amount of interference that's getting into it, just for shielding. But other than that, yeah, I think it's a pretty decent kit for a beginner who wants to get into playing with RF. Now, if you've got any questions or comments about this, please leave them down below. Thanks for watching, everybody. I'll talk to you later.